the bill, and every year we would keep going back if we didn't get one.
Everybody was like, y'all are not going to get a record deal. I mean, y'all just might as well give up.
However, their persistence would soon pay off. In 1994, while at school, the girls got some exciting news.
They called our names over the loudspeakers. They were like, Kelly Rowland and Beyonce Knowles, come to the office. So I'm like, oh my God, what did I do? And we went to the office, my dad is standing there, and he's like, y'all got y'all's record deal. Y'all are gonna move to Atlanta, we're gonna get y'all tutor. So we're like, ah!
I can't wait to go to Atlanta so I can meet TLC. Hey!
The four 13-year-olds moved to Atlanta to record a debut album for Elektra Records, but their excitement was short-lived. The deal was about to collapse.
They were too young and they were not ready.
We eventually got dropped, which was the second most devastating thing in our lives. We were about 12 and we thought that it was all over.
Next, the early stages of stardom take their toll on Destiny's Child.
The whole sisterhood thing was just going down a drain, it was not working.
And later, broken friendships send the girls into a depression.
I would have never thought that we would end up not being together.
When Lifetime's Intimate Portrait continues. Lifetime's Intimate Portrait of Destiny's Child. Beyonce, Kelly, Latavia, and Latoya were four teenagers who dreamed of stardom as an R&B group. After years of struggling, they were signed to a major record label, but were dropped after just a year. Beyonce's father, Matthew, was not discouraged. Believing in the girls' talents, he quit his corporate job to manage the group full-time. It was a major gamble that would require his entire family to make sacrifices.
It takes a father's love to work as hard as he did. He worked so many hours. No other manager would work as hard as he did, but he did.
What are we singing about? What is this song about?
All my friends were like, Matthew, you must have lost your mind. What are you doing? What are you talking about? This girl's group, it's not gonna happen. He's crazy. He's lost it.
He really felt like it was gonna happen for us. And I didn't understand at the time, but it was putting a strain on my mom and dad's marriage.
His whole focus was the group being successful and that it became before our family. So as a result of that, we separated for a while, and it was a really painful time.
For the sake of Beyonce and her younger sister Solange, Matthew and Tina struggled to repair their marriage. But friends and family urged them to give up the group.
I know that it was such a big sacrifice for my parents, for something you don't know is going to happen, but I just think that they had so much faith.
It was our dream, and I was very blessed because my dad saw the potential in us and he stood by us.
With their entire future at stake, the girls flew to New York in 1997, hoping to snag another record deal.
Matthew told us we had this interview with Columbia Records. We were like, whoa.
We did that showcase. We were so nervous.
After performing the showcase, the 16-year-olds returned to Houston, anxiously awaiting word from the label. 2 weeks later, they finally got the news.
Matthew presented us with these manila envelopes. So we open them up, and as you're pulling out, you see Columbia Records at the top. We're screaming and crying. It was so crazy. We were so excited.
7 years after the group was formed, the girls' dream finally came true. To celebrate their rebirth, they changed their name for the final time.
Tina was looking in the Bible. She looked at this word, and it was destiny. And actually, I came up with the word child. As a rebirth of destiny.
The newly christened Destiny's Child spent the next year hard at work in the recording studio. Meanwhile, the group turned into a real family affair when Beyonce's mother, Tina, became their official stylist.
I got into it to make all the girls feel equally beautiful and to try to tailor things for their specific body styles. And I also wanted them to always be beautiful and glamorous like the old Motown days when everybody looked bigger than life.
As Tina developed an image for Destiny's Child, Matthew steered the group towards their public debut, but he discovered that being a manager and a father was not easy.
Balancing the relationship with me being her father and a manager is very tough, I have to say.
If I don't agree with something, I don't hold back. Me and my dad are always at it. We're like, well, I don't think that's the best decision. Well, I don't think it's the best, you know, whatever. But we always come to a compromise, always.
On February 17th, 1998, Destiny's Child released their self-titled debut album. Critics applauded their tightly woven harmonies and funky R&B sound, and the public immediately embraced their sexy image. The record went platinum and featured their first number one hit, No, No, No.
Oh, I know you want me, I can see it in your eyes. But you keep on fighting with yourselves on your mind. Cause each and every time you meet me, you give me signs. But when I ask you what's the deal, you hold on inside.
I remember the first time my song played on the radio.
Tell me what's
we were all together. It was like, ah! We were just jumping up and down, and it was beautiful.
We were having a lot of fun, and I remember our first video shoot was so emotional because it was kind of the feeling that you've arrived.
With a growing audience and rising critical acclaim, Destiny's Child was fast becoming the toast of the music industry. On July 27, 1999, they released their second album, The Writing's on the Wall, which featured the first songs the girls co-wrote.
We wanted to write more. We wanted to be more involved so it could be us. And that's what we did. It was based on our personal experiences with guys and relationships and life. And every day in the studio, we would just talk. It was like girl talk. Whatever we said, it was in the song.
At first we started out real cool, taking me places I ain't never been. But now you're getting comfortable, ain't doing those things you did no more. You're slowly making me fight for things your money should be handling.
The Writing's on the Wall became an instant smash, selling over 10 million copies and giving Destiny's Child their second number one hit and their first controversy.
Bills, Bills, Bills was the most misunderstood song of here.
You're trifling, good for nothing type of brother.
People were complaining that we were male bashing when a lot of people weren't really listening to the song.
They thought these girls are some gold diggers. These girls think guys are supposed to pay their bills. People didn't listen to the whole story. I would ask God to pay my bills is unless he ran my bills up. And people misunderstood it, but actually that hype helped it to become the biggest R&B song of the year. So everything happens for a reason.
With two multi-platinum albums to their credit, Destiny's Child had suddenly become a major force in music. Critics applauded the craftsmanship of their songs, while the public fell in love with the four inseparable soul sisters.
With Destiny's Child, we were sisters. We were Christian girls. We were very sweet and loving to each other. People would always ask you, well, what's gonna make y'all different from the last group? Or are y'all gonna break up? We're like, no, we're gonna stay together.
But by the summer of 1999, after 7 years together, the sisterhood known as Destiny's Child had begun to unravel, as Beyoncé and Kelly suddenly found themselves increasingly estranged from LaToya and LaTavia.
Any group is all about chemistry, and that chemistry was gone.
I remember around The Writing's on the Wall was when everything really started taking its turning point, and we weren't as loving. The whole sisterhood thing was just going down the drain. It was not working. Some people wouldn't speak, and that's not what sisters do.
In December of 1999, lawyers for LaTavia Roberson and LaToya Luckett sent letters to Matthew asking that their clients be released from his management. For the four young girls who had grown up together, the loss of two friends was devastating.
That was the worst Christmas of my life.
Our house was not right around Christmas time.
It was just very, very, very disappointing, very hurtful, very unbelievable.
These were kids that had been together since they were 9 and 10, and they were like sisters, and all of a sudden, they didn't know what their future held. Everything that they had worked for was just basically gone.
We were mad, and we were sad, and you felt like everything was over.
It was like we could have been a really successful group, but what are we gonna do now?
Next, new members come and new members go.
You put girls together that don't know each other, disaster can strike.
And later, the group finds divine inspiration in three angels.
Good morning, Charlie.
When Lifetime's Intimate Portrait continues. It's Intimate Portrait of Destiny's Child. After performing together for 7 years, Destiny's Child had become the hottest new act in music. But success eventually divided the girls. And by December of 1999, LaToya Luckett and Latavia Roberson were no longer part of the group.
In any real scenario, that's something that is going to break up a group. I mean, it just is, has historically.
The tragic event destroyed Destiny's Child.